couple of weeks ago, we had a look at this book, and a few people in the comments mentioned how they'd like to see some of these experiments in action. And yeah, so would I. You know, when I was younger, I had a few of these books, and they all seemed a bit out of reach, a bit too advanced for me to carry out. I didn't have the tools, I didn't have the skills. Well, now I do have the tools. I don't know about the skills, but I guess we'll find out.
So, the book is called Experiments with Your Computer. It was published by Usborne Books in 1985, and it contains a wealth of experiments. But today we're going to be doing experiments with sensors. In particular, we're going to make a thermometer using a Commodore 64 and a few electronic components. In order to accomplish this, we're first enlightened as to what components we need. There are also a few options if you own a different micro with an analog port. The Commodore 64 has an analog control port so it can accept a mouse, so we simply need a female D-type socket for connection purposes. We also need a 100k thermistor and a 1 mega ohm 0.25 or 0.5 watt resistor. In addition, we'll need some electrical wire, some strippers, not that kind, and cutters to manipulate it. A soldering iron and a roll of insulation tape will also come in handy. I managed to pick up all the components from eBay for a few quid and had most of the other tools, so we can get cracking. There are a few different methods for each machine, but as you can see, our Commodore 64 requires the thermistor and resistor to be wired between pin 7 and 9 of the control port. You also get a few hints regarding construction and setup down below, which is nice. Okay, so I'm just using some spare speaker wire for our connection here. This has the added benefit of being in one piece, just to make our instrument a bit neater. Once the wires are stripped, I'm just going to twist the wire strands around the resistor legs, so we have one point to solder into the connection cups. The Usborne book tells us to tin the wires next. This makes them easier to solder in place, and just involves a coating of solder. You'll have to excuse my soldering technique, I haven't had much need to use one since studying electronics at college. You get an entire page of soldering hints to help you along at this point, but there are also some tutorials on YouTube if you need assistance, something we would certainly have lacked in the 1980s. Anyway, it should look something like this. We can now connect these to the pins on the D socket. You don't need much solder here, just enough to hold them in place. Any excess solder can be flicked away to make sure you don't make contact with adjacent pins. And there we go, wire and resistor connected in parallel and ready for the thermistor. And here it is. It's actually a type of resistor also, which varies its resistance depending on the temperature. Again, I'm going to twist the wires around the legs and just apply enough solder to hold it in place. That will do. We are not aiming for a prize to win best aesthetic here. So this is essentially our finished sensor. Usborne suggests you insulate the wires to make sure they don't come into contact with each other, so that is what we shall do. I actually made up two sensors at this point, one with longer cables to measure things further away from the computer, and one shorter for use on the desk. So now we move on to actually writing the program that will make sense of our input. Here's the base part of the program, all written nicely in Commodore Basic for us. Variations required for other machines can be found at the back of the book. Typing time! This is where we remember how cumbersome the 64's keyboard feels for touch typing. How accustomed to luxury we have become. So here's the program. You can see line 10 calls the routine at line 500, which sets up some rough values for our integers K1 and K2. Line 520 then returns code execution to line 20, which calls the routine at line 1000. This is where the bulk of the work is done. That peak command is retrieving the output from our thermistor and passing it to the variable TR. Our job is to then convert this output into a temperature scale we're all familiar with. In this instance, that's degrees Celsius. With the program completed, we can plug our device into control port number 1 and hope for the best. And the best is exactly what we receive! On screen spews a slurry of numbers just as the book describes. We can check it works by exposing the thermistor to body heat and notice the numbers slightly decreasing. Our job is to now find what these values equal when the thermistor is exposed to 0 degrees. So, we need some ice. Here's the ice, and if I prod the thermistor as much into it as possible and then rerun the basic, we should get some values which equate to 0 degrees. From these numbers, it's somewhere around the 470 mark. Updating the K2 variable to this number will provide the correct figure for our calculations. The book then tells me to update line 30, so we're given a more friendly and useful response. Our next task is then to find the upper end of the scale. For this, I've made myself a nice cup of tea. And say, that is a nice mug. Popping the thermistor in a bag prevents it from getting wet, and then I can just dunk it into the tea. Now, I reckon this tea is around 70 degrees C. However, the program is returning the value of around 36, 37. Thankfully, by altering our other variable, K1, we can correct the calculations to accommodate for our input. I just put 3000 in and it seemed to be pretty much spot on. To make sure, I have a grow egg thermometer to hand, which is measuring the room temperature at 23 degrees. And now safely out of a mug, it correlates very well with our readings. So, on to the fun section, the experiments. Usborne have kindly presented us with 4 experiment ideas, but they have also provided us with a graphics routine to add graph functionality to proceedings. Now, I don't know about you, but that sounds much more compelling than a list of numbers. So back to typing code. And then after that code is typed, we've got a load of other code. This is a generic graphics routine used for various programs throughout the book. But at least once you've typed it out, you can save it to tape if you remember, and save your fingers from RSI. So, here's the moment of truth. Oh yes, we have graph functionality. We get the temperature reading at the top right of the screen and a lovely little line drawn across the screen measuring temperature against time. Splendid! You can see it increase slightly with my body heat here. So I guess that's the first experiment done. We've also really done the hot water one. So next up involves chemicals. The idea here is to measure the temperature of some water, and then add soda crystals and vinegar to instigate a reaction. We can then measure the temperature increase. The book suggests a tablespoon of vinegar and 5 lumps of soda. Personally, I reckon a good shake of soda and a good glug of vinegar. We've got some fizz. But even with this, the result is rather lackluster. More chemicals, more fizz. Yeah, it's not really that impressive, is it? Okay, let's revisit the body heat and try my armpit. For this, I'll need to remove the first cable carefully and insert the longer cable. Thankfully, it seems to be calibrated spot on with the first, so we can do a quick body heat test. Armpits. And yes, as you can see, roughly the right body temperature, although apparently I have a high fever, and you can see a notable rise in the graph. But how about something more dangerous? You can see with this flame, the graph flies up to 68 degrees, and then drops off quite quickly after. So, we've done hot, how about cold again? Our bowl of ice is still melting away and yields us a result of about 3 degrees, which seems about right for a bowl of melted ice. You could spend all day with this, and I can only imagine the fun I would have had in my youth had I had the balls to create one of these experiments, but frankly I was too scared of blowing up my machine and wasting my PC fund on soldering irons. For one last test, let's check the C64 power supply temperature. A toasty 33 degrees. Well done you. So there we go. That's how to turn your Commodore 64 into a thermometer. I hope you found this experiment as satisfying to view as I did to make. Maybe next time we'll move into the light sensor page and see what wacky times are in store for us there. But for now, thanks for watching. Subscribe, share, thumb it up or down, or contribute to my Patreon if it so takes you. Otherwise, have a great evening!